Kugan Cassius here for iFILM Liverpool. I've renamed it Liverpool because it only makes sense. So this is the road you actually grew up. This is where Tony Bellew grew up.
Yeah, this is the road. This is Portman Road in Waverley, part of Liverpool. And this is where, for me, it all started.
Well, I mean, what was it like growing up here? Was it, I mean, obviously, I don't think I'm rudely saying, was it a rough area here?
Yeah, well, listen, I mean, you look around, everybody's close, but then you go best going left here. This is Lawton's Road. You know, it's that was my junior school there, my infant and junior school on your right. All these shops are now changing, some of them are shut down, some of them are closed, you know, some bookies now off licences, and as you say, a lot of pubs and stuff like that, but this is just Liverpool for you, you know, this is the south part of Liverpool, and it's, while it was tough and rough, I wouldn't have changed it for the world, because, you know, my upbringing's made me what I am today.
So, that upbringing, where, what makes it happen for you to turn where you grew up and your lifestyle from when you was younger to what you've become today?
I think, see, coming up here, I used to spend day after day walking up to this road now. We're coming up Lawton's Road and on to a place called Ale Road. We used to have a fantastic youth centre up here called The Wreck.
Yeah.
And, you know, we used to go there as kids. All kinds were going there, from football to table tennis to snooker to actually fighting between ourselves. So we just do anything and everything, and you know, it's just this is what makes you what you are. You know, I come back here and I look at this place. This used to all be houses. Everything here was just houses. These have all been knocked down and bulldozed. Now it's ground zero. The youth centre that we had there is now gone. This is what I'm telling about the youth today. They don't have the youth centres that we used to have.
Yeah.
And there's nothing for the kids in the area to do, but the five-a-side football pitch we used to play on every Sunday, that's still there. No, it's just, it is what it is. You're best taking a left up here.
Yeah.
It's a, it is a deprived area, and if you look around, you know, you can see it for yourself, but it's not going to change that. It's still, for me, a great area. I loved living here, and this place will always continue to be close to me, no matter what I do or where I go. It'll always be close to me, this place, without doubt.
Do you know, people think you're a bit of a nutter, don't they? They think you're a bit of a hothead.
Yeah.
Where's that come from? Where's this? Is that true when people refer to you as a bit hot-headed and a bit temperamental? You know, are they right in saying that? Or is that just a thing we see in boxing?
No, listen, I'm a different person. You're best going right up here. I'm a different person to when I'm boxing to when I'm just seeing day-to-day people. You know, listen, I'm not a lunatic. I'm not a crazy guy. I'm just a normal, level-headed guy, to be honest, with a family and just trying to earn a living. But listen, when people look at things differently to me. I'm a boxer, and when you go into a fight, you can say it's a sport as much as you want, but basically, it's not a sport. It's somebody trying to hurt me and take away what I've got, and I don't like them. I don't want to be around them, and when I am around them, I just want to do them damage, and that's just the mentality that I've got, that's drove into me. But when I'm away from boxing, I'm easygoing. I'm a good person, I like to believe, and I'm just normal. I'm just the same as everybody else on the street, from, like I always say, from a taxi driver to the guy working in that shop to a barmaid working in that pub. I'm just the same as everybody else. It's just that I happen to be punching people in the face for a living. That's the only difference, but I'm just the same as yourself and everybody else.
Do you think you'll ever change that view of your life?
No. I'm always going to be the same, because I've got the same background as everybody in this area. I've got the same background as 90% of the world. I'm just a normal person from a normal background. And that can never obviously change. It's what made me what I am, and no matter what I do in boxing or what I ever earn through boxing, it's not going to change me, because you can't change what you are. You can only just go with it and just be who you are and what you are.
What is it about Liverpool at the moment? Because Liverpool's got a great history of fighters, and at the moment as well, there's a lot of good fighters coming out of Liverpool, like yourself and this, you know, Smith brothers,
yeah,
and Sederi yesterday, and Rocky Fielding, all these people. What is it about Liverpool that's producing fighters?
I said it a long time ago, best thing in this left lane. I said it a long time ago that gave you two things from Liverpool, and I stick by it, even though I got a lot of stick and criticism for saying it. You two things from Liverpool, you're either great at telling jokes, or you can either fight.
Which one are you? Well, you might be both, I don't know.
I'd like to think I can have a bit of a fight, but I'd also like to think that, you know, I can have a laugh and a joke, and I'm not a serious person. Listen, Oliver Allison said to me yesterday, West Enders left, where are you going to do your next left? Oliver Allison said to me yesterday, I can't believe when I spend time around you, you're the same person that I see around you when it comes close to fight nights. And he says, you must be one of the most intimidating, nastiest, ferocious people I've ever seen. And I told him, I said, I'm just like you, mate.
There's a lot of people saying that about you.
No, listen, I don't know. I don't know what they're seeing, because I don't see it.
Do you know what I think it is? I think it's obviously a lot of the boxing public, they'll watch your post-fight interviews, pre-fight interviews, press conferences. And like you said, you're in fight mode. You're ready to take someone's head off. Mm. So they're not going to see maybe this side of you.
Yeah.
Or, yeah, listen, I can tell by speaking to you, I can tell by reading your tweets that you're a proper family man. You know? Yeah. I can tell that's the most important thing in your life. That's obvious for anyone to tell. But I think unless people read these tweets and unless they sort of see a different side of you, I think that's probably what, you know, what they think. But
it's just, that's the way it goes. Listen, that's going to be the perception 90% of people have of me. And then when they meet me, it's like, you're a different person to what I thought. This is where I was born, this is Mulgrave Street. I lived here for the first year of my life or two. And then we moved back down to where you've just seen me come from. This is now Toxteth, the heart of Toxteth. This is where the riots took place. This is where my elder brothers lived. This is Mulgrave Street. You're going to go out left here and left again, and then you come onto the, what people like to call it, the famous. I don't think it's famous, the famous Granby Street.
What do they call it, the famous?
The famous Granby Street. This was the place where, I think this is where the riots really, really started. It's a place like this because it was a built-up area. Predominantly black, where my mum was from. And as I say, you know, it was this was the place where it all really started, to be honest.
When you was growing up, was you more into your football than your boxing?
Oh yeah, listen, yeah. I dreamed of being a footballer. I still do. I still have dreams of playing for Everton Football Club one day. But the matter of the fact is, I'm just not good enough at football
what
as
position,
I am at boxing.
What position,
I'd love to have played up front. Duncan Ferguson was my idol, and it's crazy now because he's like my friend. That's doing a left here, this next left coming up. It's crazy because he left here. He's my friend. I just can't get my head around that. This is Granby Street. I actually speak and have general every other day chats with Duncan Ferguson.
So if you could have partnered anyone who was an Everton forward while you was like, since you've been born, rather, it would have been Duncan Ferguson.
Oh, without a shadow of a doubt.
Not Daniel Amakechi?
No, not Amo. It would have been Big Dunk. Without doubt, two big lanky dopes up front it would have been. But he's far better with his feet than me.
Please tell me why this street is famous again. Everything seems boarded up.
Listen, it's different now. This used to be really lively years ago. I remember coming here. I used to come here bonfire night. I used to be here for the carnivals. We used to be here for... Now it's different. Now everything's boarded up, knocked down, smashed. This used to just be all shops, houses, terraced houses. This was a great place to be years ago. When I think about some of the memories I have of this place, it's a fantastic place. It really is. I've got my best friend who plays football for Leicester. He was raised right on this street at two different parts, just down there by the Methodist, and then also again just a little bit further up there. It's a great place. Then we've got other people that used to be up and around here, other friends. I've got one who lives there now, and Dev. They're just all good people. As I say, everyone goes on about this road, but for me, it's just a great place. It's just a really good place. Not what it used to be, but, and all the shops are closed now. The barber shop used to be on here, Ken's. Everybody was here. John Barnes used to get his hair cut there.
Did he?
Michael Thomas. And we'd be going in as kids getting our hair cut and bits like that. And you'd be seeing some of the players and stuff like that. It is what it is. A little useless today. It's just a different place now. But this is like the heart of Toxteth. It's nothing. nothing different that's in any other area of, say, London, Birmingham, Leeds, Liverpool, all these areas are the same, they're just deprived areas that produce good and bad. That's, you know, every area is the same for me.
Would you say he was an obsessive trainer?
Yeah.
Because that's how you're looked at as a bit of an OCD with the training.
Yeah, I am a bit, bit of, once I get into camp, once it gets to, at this moment in time, let's go on, right, yeah.
Right,
I'm not too heavy with it at the minute. Don't get me wrong, I'm training twice a day, every day, Monday to Friday, once on the Saturday, Sunday's rest. But I'm not OCD with it just yet. It'll get to the stage when it gets to 8 weeks to go, maybe 10, I'll start. Everything's written down from every single press up to every single sit up. I'll target the punches that I've thrown in a session. I'll target the rounds I've done. I'll write down what we've done in each round and just things like that. I've done that for the last 5 years of my boxing life. It's just
straight up.
It's just part of me. I don't know. I think half of it was because when I was an amateur, I wouldn't go as far as I make a strong statement as to say I cheated. But what I did do is I didn't do things right.
Yeah.
I didn't live the life that I live now because I was half cocky and confident that I thought I could knock everybody out. That was the first thing, because I was winning, you know, titles at weights that I shouldn't have been fighting at. And then the second one was I thought I don't need to really go into depth as, you know, so far deep into things as I would, because I'm only fighting 4 2-minute rounds. When I went professional, my missus had just had my first little boy at that time, and then I started getting a lot more serious at that point. I was about to walk out the amateurs, my little boy was just born, and then, you know, that was it then.
Did you say you're over your disappointment of the Nathan Cleverley fight now?
It is what it is. It was a close fight, it was a hard fight, it was a great fight for the public. I don't get me wrong, I still don't think I lost, but, you know, I'm not going out there and saying I've been robbed. I'm not going to go out there and say I got robbed, because that's just an untrue statement. To say I've been robbed is wrong. Do I feel I haven't been cheated fairly? Yet I do, because everybody who's anybody and knows the boxing knows I've won X amount of rounds in that fight, and for the scores to be like they were or to do it, it's just unfair. But listen, life goes on. I don't need Nathan Cleverley. All as I need to do is keep improving, and, you know, I believe I'll get to where I'm destined to be.
All right, well, Tony, listen, thank you very much for talking to us.
No problem.
It's good to see where you grew up, because we come to Liverpool and we only come to where we know, because I don't want to start wandering about the streets.
This is Lodge Lane. This is great here. There's 9 barber shops on this road. 9 barber shops on one road. So if you can't get a decent fade here, you're not going to get a decent fade anyway. I should send Danny McIntosh up here, because I've seen his fade and it looks like something out of Megamind, the cartoon movie. So if when he comes to Liverpool, after I've knocked him out, or before he comes to the way and I terrorise him, tell him he should come to Lodge Lane, get his hair cut up here, and get a decent fade for once in his life.
I'm sure he'll take you up on that.
I hope he does, because his fade's dreadful. It's like a buzz cut, something out of the Navy.
I'm not going to comment on that. I'm not going to comment on that.
Wait till you see him.
Oh, well, listen, we'll look forward to your fight anyway. You know, we haven't seen you in the ring since October.
Can't
so,
wait. You know, it's not long now.
Like I said, thank you for taking us around here, because I would not come here of my own back dressed in a red tracksuit from Essex.
I wouldn't come on that tracksuit anyway, to be totally honest.
What's wrong with it?
You look like a bad tomato. But listen, I still love you. I've still got mad love for you.
I know.
So that's all that matters.
Listen, I will say something about you. From day one, from day one of when we started, you've always just, well, you couldn't have given us more time, to be honest. So
listen, it's just, it's without guys like you, the sport wouldn't be thriving at the moment like it is, because you guys, I don't know how you get the motivation to be coming all the way up here from Essex and you know, getting behind the guys and taking time out to interview them, from the likes of Anthony Joshua, you know, to coming up to see Derry Matthews as well, and things like that, you know, to keep them boxing alive, because the fact is, it hasn't been as mainstream as it was, and boxing is not the great sport it was perceived to be in the past. Your days of Ben and Eubank and Nazim Ahmed, they're gone, and it's different now. It's like boxing needs you know, reigniting again, and it needs a little bit more input, and you know, the likes of you guys are doing it, and that's great, that's fantastic
you
for
know
the
what,
sport.
Tony, it's like, we don't, listen, we're not claiming to be experts, I'm not claiming, listen, I've never boxed, my partner James has never boxed, we're, you know, we're ultimately, we're fans, and we're just, we're trying to, what we're trying to do is put this between an expert's view and a fan's view, we're trying to sit somewhere in between. And like I said, I'm not, we don't claim to know everything about boxing, we're just doing what we do, and we hope that, you know, the following we've had from the last year we've done it, that it just moves forward, because we like doing it, that's the main thing. And you know
what, you know, what the good thing is, you're a fan of boxing, but you're giving something to boxing and boxing fans, and that's something that, you know, I'm a fan of boxing, and hopefully I'm doing my bit for boxing, but anybody who's a boxing fan, you know, tune into these channels and do your bit to help boxing as well, because the more people that know about boxing, the more it gets out, the bigger the sport's going to grow, and the better it's going to be, not just for the fighters, but for the fans, and you know, for the sport in general.
Yeah, I appreciate that. And listen, you want to hope that I don't ever come down to light heavy.
Listen, if you make light heavy, I'm doing welter. Simple as that.
If I can get down to light heavy, you know what I mean?
I'll, it's start... a struggle enough for me to get down to 12-7. So if you get, if you, I'll make it a bet. Yeah. If you get to 13 stone, I'll make my middleweight debut.
About 5 and a half stars.
Yeah, I'll do my middleweight debut. I'll do 11-6. I'll that, chop something
listen,
off.
That division would be in trouble. Hopkins, Cleverly, listen, you'd all be in trouble.
I'm never calling out Papa Hopkins, mate. I ain't messing around people like him. But listen, you think where I'm from's kind of rough. Where he's from's a whole new ball game. They're taking the likes of me as prisoners in there and making me work for them. Where I've been living, they're just saying hello and waving goodbye. Where he's from, they're locking you up in rooms the size of like cages and stuff like that. You know what I'm saying? That's how you're raised.
All right, well, listen, we're going to head back with you, obviously.
Spot on.
So thank you very much.
Thanks for having me.
Tony Bellew, iFILM Liverpool here. It's been renamed for the weekend. Goes back to normal Monday, by the way.
iFILM Liverpool. Every time he comes up in this kind of part of the woods. It's my iFILM Liverpool.
Thank you very much.
Anytime. I'm Tony Bellew, and you've been watching iFILM Liverpool.